He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave Explains.
Hey guys, I wanted to work through some more stuff on ChemDoodle today. Specifically, I wanted to go through some problems involving proton NMR spectra. And in doing so, I'll show you some cool features on here. Most notably, we can generate NMR spectra for any molecule. So this will be very useful for, let's say, assigning peaks to a spectrum from a molecule. So we can take some example like this, any molecule you want, and we'll go right here to spectrum, and we will notice we can do either proton or C13. Right now, let's do proton NMR. And so this is the spectrum. This is the proton NMR spectrum that corresponds to this molecule that we've drawn right here. And so this is very useful because now we can practice this with any molecule we want. You don't have to rely on my examples. You can put in any of the molecules from your problem sets, from your quizzes or exams or whatever, and you can practice here. You can generate the spectrum and then you can assign the peaks. So just as a warm up right here, before we do some trickier stuff, let's just go ahead and assign these protons to the peaks on the spectrum. So let's take a look over here. We've got this guy right there. We would expect that to be integrated to 3. And we would expect that to be a singlet because there is no neighboring hydrogens. So that is one peak we would expect. Over here, we've got our carboxyl proton. And that's certainly going to be integrated to 1. And it's certainly going to be a singlet. So just looking at some of the integration and splitting behavior first. Then over here, we've got these two. Now, these two are on the same carbon, and usually when we have protons on the same carbon, they're chemically equivalent. Here, it's a little bit different. So let's go ahead and assign these peaks first, then we'll talk about these alkene protons. So we have got this methyl group right here. That is going to be integrated to 3, it's going to be a singlet, and we would expect it to be relatively upfield, because alkanol protons usually are a bit upfield. So if we're going to call that A, let's understand that this right here, that's got to be A right there, right? This is definitely the most upfield. It is a singlet. It is a very tall peak because it's integrated to 3. So that makes perfect sense. We're going to assign that one right there. Likewise, the carboxyl proton is very easy to assign because we know that it is always going to be very, very downfield. It's going to be past the aromatic region. And there it is right here, past 11, almost 12. So if we call that one B, then that has got to be B right here. So we have got this methyl assigned, and we've got this carboxyl proton assigned. So this is a little bit new. In my previous NMR tutorial, we didn't really fully talk about this, but this is an important thing to understand because, once again, normally the protons all that are on the same carbon are chemically equivalent. But it's going to be a little bit different for alkene protons. And the reason is this. When you have sigma bonds result from the direct overlap of orbitals. And so there is free rotation on that internuclear axis. And so the groups are spinning. And if the protons are spinning around, then if they're seeing a different part of the molecule at one moment, then they're seeing another one at another moment. And so all three or two or however many protons, they're gonna, as they flip around, see the same environment. But when we have a pi bond like this, recall that the pi bond, we've got a sigma bond, but then we have a pi bond, which is the result of the lateral overlap of those unhybridized p orbitals. So those are locked into place. There is no rotation about this pi bond. So what that means is that these protons are locked into a specific chemical environment. So this proton is necessarily closer to that methyl group, and this proton is necessarily closer to that carboxyl group. So they are going to experience a different chemical shift because they are experiencing a different chemical environment, or they're going to exhibit a different chemical shift, rather. And so what we want to understand is that one of these peaks here corresponds to one of these protons and the other corresponds to the other. So which is which? Well, this one is closer to the methyl group, which is less deshielding. This one is closer to the carboxyl group, which is more deshielding because it's got those oxygens in there. So if we call this one C, we would expect C to be more downfield. So that's C right there. And then let's go ahead and call this D. And then D would be the one that is a little bit more upfield. And we can see there's a little bit of splitting going on. They are likely splitting each other. But in terms of chemical shift, that's where they're at. And this does make sense in terms of a range for alkene protons. And we're just understanding that the discrepancy in their chemical shift is due to the difference in the chemical environment, what they are seeing on the other side of that double bond. So that was a quick warm-up. We just saw how easy it is to take any molecule and on ChemDoodle generate the NMR spectrum, and then we can do any kind of assignment or analysis from there. So let's go and do some other examples now. Okay, let's try one where we're given a structure and we have to predict the spectrum. We have to figure out what the spectrum is going to look like. So let's go ahead here and take a look at how many resonance we might expect. Let's find all the chemically equivalent protons. So over here, we've got a CH3. So we're going to expect that to integrate to 3. And what is the splitting going to be? We know that we've got two hydrogens next door right here. So these two hydrogens are going to split this signal into a triplet, right? Because of the N plus one rule. So two next door, this should be a triplet. Right here, we've got something that should be integrated to 2. And what is the splitting pattern going to be? So we've got 3 right here. We've got 2 right here. That's a total of 5. So this peak should be split into 6 smaller peaks, which is starting to get pretty messy. So we can even just call that a multiplet. You could call it a sextuplet, but it might, we sometimes over 5, we just sort of call it a multiplet. Then once again over here, we've got, these are 2 protons. So we are going to expect that to be integrated to 2. And we've got 2 protons next door right there, 2 protons next door right here. That's a total of 4. So we should expect this resonance to be split into 5 peaks. Again, that's maybe we can just call it a multiplet. It'll be split quite a bit. And then right here, we've got another peak. We've got 2 H's. We've got 2 chemically equivalent protons right here. And we've got only 2 next door. There are no protons next door on this carbon. This carbon has its other bonds to oxygen, not to hydrogen. So there's 2 next door. That will split it into 3. We're going to expect this to be a triplet. And then lastly, we've got our carboxyl proton. That has got to show up as a singlet. And it'll be integrated to 1. Of course, there's only 1 of them. So we've got some information here about integration. We've got some information, some predictions we've made about splitting patterns. In terms of chemical shift, again, we're talking about the proximity of these protons to this oxygen-containing functional group. So the further away the protons are, the more upfield they're going to be. And so as we go down this molecule closer to this functional group, the resonances should get further and further downfield. So as we go this way, we should be going downfield. we're going to start over here. This is pretty far away from anything that would be deshielding, so this should be close to around 1 ppm. And then as we get a little closer, we're going to get a little up to 2, maybe a little past 2 ppm. So, you know, maybe around 1 to around 2 to 2.5, maybe somewhere in that region, right? Because we're not very deshielded. Maybe this one a little bit more, but this is all pretty upfield. Then over here, this guy, the carboxyl proton, we know that that's going to be very far downfield, usually around 11, something like that. So this is giving us a very clear picture of what this structure, what this spectrum should look like. So let's take a look at let's generate our NMR spectrum. Let's go to generate and then generate our proton NMR spectrum. And so that's what this thing is going to look like. Okay, so I went ahead and put that down here so we can see all of our data. And we can see that we were really spot on here. We do have the most upfield. The most upfield peak is this triplet. We've got a triplet. And that does look to be integrated a bit higher than the other peaks because it does correspond to 3 protons. So there is our triplet. We can see those three smaller peaks. And next, we do have this, slightly more downfield, we have this multiplet right there. And we can even count the six peaks. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. There are all six peaks that correspond to the splitting pattern for this resonance. Then, a little more downfield, we have this other multiplet, or we could call it a quintuplet. So there is that. We've got this 2H, right? It seems to be integrated to about the same height as this other one. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 smaller peaks. And then we do have this triplet. We have this last resonance for the aliphatic protons. And so that is up to 2, and it is a triplet. And we do see that everything falls pretty neatly into that region that we expected, a little under 1 to a little over 2. That makes a lot of sense in terms of corresponding with these types of protons. And then over here, we do have our carboxyl proton that is way up there past 11 as we expected. And so that is clearly distinct from the rest of this data here. But so that's what we've done. We took this structure and we predicted the NMR spectrum. We predicted the integration, we predicted the splitting patterns, and we predicted chemical shift, and we saw that it matched the generated proton spectrum very nicely. Okay, so let's try one here where we are going from the spectrum to the structure. So this is a different type of question that we may have to answer. And so for something like this, let's say we are given this spectrum and we have this data and we're also given a molecular formula. So let's say that we know the molecule is C4O2H8. So there's four carbons. This data is going to tell us about these eight protons, but then we have to figure out what the molecule looks like. Now with these oxygens, it can be kind of tricky because we have to figure out, are those two separate hydroxyl groups? Are those two separate carbonyls? Are they part of the same functional group? Are they part of an ester or a carboxylic acid? And if we had some IR data, that might tell us more about what kinds of functional groups those oxygens can be found in. So without that, it's a little bit trickier, but this is a pretty simple molecule, so we should still be able to do it. We'll just sort of go fragment by fragment. We'll look at each piece and figure out what that is telling us about what must be present on the molecule. So let's start over here. We have a triplet. See, this is a triplet, and let's say it's integrated to 3. So the thing is that almost always when we have a signal that is integrated to 3, that's got to be a methyl group. So it's very difficult to find 3 chemically equivalent protons that are not part of a methyl group. So usually we can just go ahead and bet that this means there's a methyl group somewhere. And it is a triplet, so it must be adjacent to a carbon with 2 protons on it. So that's something that we want to be aware of. Over here, we have another resonance that is integrated to 3. So this has got to be another methyl group. So we've got 2 methyls. The only difference here is that this one is a singlet. So it is next door to a carbon with no hydrogens on it. So let's start to fill this in. So we've got a methyl over there. We've got a methyl over here, and we've got some stuff in between. We don't really know what's in between yet, but we've got a methyl and we've got a methyl. Over here, this is integrated to 2. And it's a quartet. So that means we probably have a CH2, right? Usually when something is integrated to 2, it means that those are 2 protons on the same carbon. So we have a CH2 somewhere. And now the thing is, this is a quartet. See, we can clearly see the 4 peaks right here. So if it's a quartet, it means that it is probably going to be next to a CH3. Or it could be a slightly different scenario, but here we have 2 methyls, so that makes a lot of sense for this CH2 to be adjacent to a methyl. So let's just arbitrarily pick one of these. Let's say we put a carbon here, and we do that. So this is already starting to make some sense. Now, we're missing 1 carbon, right? We have 3 carbons placed, and we have all of the hydrogens placed, But so we're missing one carbon and two oxygens. So given that this methyl, remember, this methyl represents this singlet right here. And the singlet means that it must be next to a carbon with no hydrogens on it, right? So there's, because there's no splitting at all, there are no neighboring hydrogens. And that actually makes a lot of sense here, because if we have two oxygens, then we can go ahead and place that final carbon right here. Now, how do we get away with having no hydrogens on this carbon? Well, we've got two oxygen atoms, so let's put the rest of the bonds to this carbon going from this carbon going to oxygen. So what if we make a carbonyl and then an oxygen there? Now we've got an ester, right? So this works perfectly. We've got this guy is corresponding to this one, right? That's going to be this methyl over here. And then we've got these two corresponding to this one. And then we've got this methyl corresponding to this as well. And all of the chemical shifts also make sense, because we've got this this methyl is clearly going to be the most upfield, because it's the furthest away from any oxygen containing functional groups. And so there we see that it is almost up to one there. And it is a triplet because it is next to a carbon with two hydrogens on it. And then over here, we've got a little bit more upfield. This methyl is next to this ester group, and it is a singlet. And then this one is going to be the most downfield because it is right next to this oxygen. And it's a quartet because it is next to this methyl group. So we've got three hydrogens splitting these two protons into a quartet. So that is our guess here, and that ends up working out pretty well. So that's that example. So as you can see, this is a tremendously useful utility. You can take any molecule, it can be very complicated, whatever it is, and you can go ahead and get that spectrum. You can generate that spectrum, and you can just make up any molecule. If you're thinking, what would a spectrum look like if it had this functional group next to this functional group? You can think of whatever you want, and you'll see what that spectrum would look like. So we just use this utility to assign peaks. We did one to predict a spectrum, and we did one where we used a spectrum to predict the molecular structure. So there's a lot of ways to use this. Once again, if you want to check out ChemDoodle and use this feature or any of the features that I've shown you so far, check out the link in the description. It's very affordable, perfect for students, and so I hope you'll check it out. Until next time.
Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.